to my dear mother. Our great ancestors have left us a wonderful adage. Wuni wua, webusnyasa. The departure of one's mother to eternity terminates one's blood relationships on earth. Your passing away leaves me homeless. I thank the good Lord for giving you to me for 66 years as my mother. You have indeed been my all. You did not only give me life, you gave me life that is worth living. You brought me up in the cultural traditions of our forefathers. You gave me the best of humanity to make me what I am today. You were a beacon of wisdom to me. You loved me and my siblings. And you did everything for us except condone evil in our lives. You were a disciplinarian to the core. You were the mother with whom I conferred. The members of our great clan and others always looked up to you. You were a jack on whom we wholly depended. You were a killer of hunger for us, our savior. The slender arm full of kindness. The ruler whose strengths were on all hearts. You taught us the value of hard work. As a young boy, you did not want me to be pampered. How can I thank you enough for preparing me for a position of glory as the king of Asante, which you so generously and affectionately bestowed on me? As your baby king, you continue to provide for me the pool of wisdom to drink from. You were with me in my moments of joy and fulfillment, and moments of sorrow and frustration. Obatimpa, who used the precious bodom beads in cracking palm nuts, you have done what you can for Asantemae and Ghana. You have helped me as my mother in a double sense, not to disgrace you in my function as Asantehene. Owahine, Asantemae joins me in mourning the passing away of our Asantehema. You will in time be succeeded by a successor to be chosen by me. But in the meantime, I have lost that which cannot be replaced. I have lost the mother who gave me life, my fountain of advice and counsel, and the anchor of my very existence. You were the center of my life. I owe everything I have achieved in life to you, to the unbounded love that you always showed to me and to the gentle tutoring that I received from you. You have been the example that has guided me and the beacon by which I have steered through life. You were not just my mother, you were also a mother to many others. With your passing away, many have lost a mother and a worthy example. To me, you are irreplaceable. You have been my rudder and my guide, the mother of mothers. Without you, life will never be the same again for me. Old lady will forever remain unique to me. You made me proud by the example you set. and you gave me confidence by your very presence. It gave me immense pleasure to observe the very easy relationship that you struck with all people, including the famous and well-known and the insignificant and obscure. You instilled in me true pride in my ancestry and joy in my pedigree. But you also taught me to show respect to everyone, regardless of their status in life. I shall miss you every day of my life. You were to me the very epitome of royalty and style. I was especially delighted and felt very proud when you were selected by my brother, Otumfuo Opokuwari II, as Asantehima. In that capacity, you projected majesty and royalty. But to me, you remained special in many ways. As a source of advice and counsel, you were incomparable. As a loving parent, you were unmatched. As the example in my life, you have been without parallel. You have been the dependable pillar of strength on whom I've been able to rely all my life. You have been there for me in the most difficult situations of my life. I particularly recall my early days when you used to visit my late uncle, Ohneba Mensabonsu, Hyangne, to check on me without me knowing you were my mother, pretending you were visiting your brother and sister, Enamasewa, at Ashanti New Town. In a similar way, Otumfuo Se Osei Ajemai Prempe II, as Santehine, my uncle, would also make visits from time to time to check on me. On all these occasions, as you and my uncle Ohneba Mensabonsu were to reveal later, I was introduced as the son of my uncle. I became convinced that the training, the upbringing, and the tutelage I had after being removed from the comfort of royalty at Menshia Palace to Ashtown, all the way to Sefiriosu, were all decisions that were taken in my interest. I'm forever grateful to you, to my uncle Otumfuo Se Osei Ajemai Prempe II Asantehine, and to a greater extent, my uncle, Ohneba Mensabonsu, your beloved brother. As Asantehine, it was my duty to look after and care for you, but you rather looked after and cared for me. Always eager to find out from Yao and Esso and my dear wife, Lady Julia, whether I'd eaten or not. You would check with Sanahine and Ananomsahine why I had sat for so long adjudicating over cases. Your worry was that litigation would never end in Asantemai. You always advised me not to sit for long hours because it was not good for my health. You enjoyed seeing me in the mornings after my return from playing golf or after my exercise from the gym, sweating because I was looking after my health. You made it a point for me to phone you every morning when I traveled outside the country to enable you to know whether I was all right. I still remember when I delayed in telephoning because I might have had an early meeting, only to be told upon telephoning later by either Ajemai Bedu, Kofi Enchi, or Akwesi your attendance. You had not eaten your breakfast because I had not called. I still recollect the excitement you showed upon realizing that I had called, and the first query was why it had taken me so long to phone. Whatever answer I gave in reply was very satisfactory because you had heard from me, a loving mother indeed. The two of us enjoyed our wheelchair rounds as age began to take its toll, with me pushing you around your compound, stopping intermittently to have a chat, and also enjoying the fresh air outside. I remember you cautioning me that we should be very careful not to let any of the chiefs see us, lest you would be reprimanded for letting the Asante Hine push your wheelchair, and me responding that I was doing that for my mother as a son. You laughed about it. Surely, the caution was because of how you cherished and respected the position of Asante Hine. Even though you knew nothing about Freemasonry, you still inquired about when next my lodge meeting and my brothers were coming for banquet. The reason? Because you always prepared some traditional foods like boswa, siwie, atidia to add up to the food to be served. Your adoption of Sir Samjona Kwesi Kakraba, whom you affectionately referred to as Mebobwase, and Chief Sir Osawaru Ifenedien, Esama of Benin Kingdom, Nigeria, as your sons, assures me that I still have brothers that I can rely on. I'm also forever grateful to you for my dear wife, Lady Julia. When I told you that I had met someone I wanted to marry, you asked to see her first before I took a decision. You then asked me upon her introduction to leave her with you for a while, just the two of you, and should come back for her later, which I obliged. After a while, you asked for her to be brought back to me. Upon seeing you the next day and inquiring from you about your meeting with my wife-to-be, you said you were not ready yet to give me an answer and that I should come the next day.
You were permitted to do for me and for many others. I shall never forget what you represented and all that you did for me and for my family. I also thank you for the motherly love that you gave to my paternal siblings, Amajimai and the rest, all of whom you looked after as your uterine children. I hereby give this vow. I shall remain true to your advice, and I shall forever remember and live by your words of wisdom. I shall also love you for the rest of my life, and I shall never forget nor ignore your many words of advice and the example of your life. Nor shall I ever forget what you have been to me and Nana Penny and my late brothers and sister. I shall always remember and live by your wise advice and helpful warnings. Otumfo Amame, rest in perfect peace. May you have the peaceful repose that you have earned. I thank you for your many good works, for your shining example, and for your words of wisdom to me and many others. Nanahima Nanti Ye.
A true offspring of the royal lineage of the Oyoko clan of Kumasi, Nana Fiakobi Sawampim II was born in 1905 in Kumasi to Nana Ya Brago, also known as Nana Ya Bakani, the daughter of Nana Kwefriye, whose mother was Nana Fiakobi I, Asante Hima from 1857 to 1880, after whom she was named. Nana Ya Brago's sister was Nana Kwes Akosua Hinafrawo, who gave birth to Nana Sewanya Amna Sewanya Akon, the 12th Asante Hima, and Nana Kwe Chamansa, whose son was Otumfo Pokwari, II, the 15th Asante Hima. The father of Nana Fia was Ohiniba Kojua Fodua I. He was Asamponhini, who reigned from 1901 to 1973. He hailed from Achiasi and was a son of Otumfo Mensabunsu, Asante Hini from 1874 to 1883. Nana Kwefriye had an older sister, Nana Yecha, from the same mother, Nana Fiakobi I, Asante Hima. Nana Yecha gave birth to Nana Kwia Bakuma and to Nana Kwadu Yadom, the 11th Asante Hima, 1917 to 1944, and also to Otumfo Ajima Prempeh I and others. Nana Kwia Bakuma gave birth to Otumfo Osajima Prempeh II, Nana Kosia Banye, and others. Nana Fia was born in a small room in a bright morning without the traditional birth attendant. The birth was heralded by an unusual incident of cocks jumping up and down with outstretched wings and continuous crowing. A traditional priest blessing her foretold that she would attain unusual longevity. The birth of Nana Fia took place 9 years after the exile of Otumfo Ajima Prempeh I by the British, first to Elmina, then to Freetown, and eventually in 1900 to the Seychelles Islands. The exiling of the king and other royals resulted in the Oyoko royals being scattered all over the kingdom. This eventually affected Nana Fia, her mother, and her siblings. They stayed at Mada in a shrine house until King Prempeh I returned to Kumasi in 1924. They then went first to stay at the Akumuyiri's house palace at Asafo, and then later to the Menshia Palace, till Nana Fia moved to live with a stool wife of the Asante Hini called Ohiniri Nana Fia Fokuo. With a smooth, dark complexion, Nenefia grew beautifully and physically strong. She manifested virtues of humility, submission, and hard work. In line with the prevailing climate that royals should not go to school, she did not have the privilege of a classroom education. But she was fully educated and tutored in matters of behavior, culture, hygiene, self-help, and so on. Her specialty was cooking various Asante dishes, such as siwe, eto, edibianchiniwomu, apraprasa, mfohu, and boswa. These were mouth-watering starters that she served her guests before they were invited to the main meal. She was ushered into womanhood through the performance of the Bragro ceremony when she reached the age of puberty. Even at that time, Nana believed in cleanliness of the body, of clothing and surroundings as a veritable mark of a truly cultured person. These traits singled her out as an Asante woman throughout her 111 years on earth. Through her first marriage to Opanin Kofi Fofie of Besiansi near Atimeti in the Kwabre district of Asante, she was blessed with three children. Nana Makwaedu, popularly called Nana Penyin, still alive, the late Bemba Kwabnapoku, and the late Nana Amasewa. One of quite a few remarkable incidents in the life of Nenefia was that it took the intervention of a traditional priest to make her deliver Nana Makunedu safely and easily. Her second marriage was to Ohinenana Kwame Bwache Dankwa, who hailed from Kentinche in the Achuma Kwangoma district of Asante. Ohinenana Bwache Dankwa succeeded his father, Kwaku Duagari of Brashiahine, in charge of Otumfuo's gun carriers. And he was also the grandson of Nana Kwaku Duagari I, Asante Hine from 1834 to 1867. The marriage, which produced two sons, Bema Kwasi Prempe of blessed memory, and Bema Kwakudia, the present Asantini, Otumfuo Osaitutu II, had the full support of Otumfuo Sir Osajuma Prempe II, her brother. It is said that after the birth of Bema Akwasi Prempe, Nenefia was contemplating to seek divorce, but Otumfuo Sir Osajuma Prempe II advised against it. Nenefia listened to her brother, and soon after, she conceived Bema Kwakudia. The day Nenefia called on her brother to present Bema Kwakudia, the child wet Otumfuo's cloth, whereupon Otumfuo's Osajuma Prempe tapped the child's head three times, saying, "Kratumi, kratumi, kratumi, wabatnasi," literally meaning powerful soul, powerful soul, powerful soul. I wish you long life. He prophesied that this young boy would be great one day, specifically that one day he would sit on Bagumaso. Nenefia Kubisewa II cherished her relationships with her paternal relations, especially Ohinebe Mensah-Bonsu, Hiahine, who took special care of Bema Kwekudia, the last child of Nenefia Kubise Wampim II, now Otumfo Osei-Tutu II, Asantehene. He trained him on the instructions of Otumfo Osagyemang Prempeh II to be capable of excelling in most standards of human life during his youth. Other paternal relations were the late Enoa Masewa, the late Ohinebe Osei-Bonsu, Nenekwea Ampimfa, the late Nana Krapa Enam, Nana Majimai, Hiawuhima. Also, Nenefia had innumerable companions who included Nana Yamponsa of Ohinebe Tipinhin's Palace, Kumasi, the late Nenekwea Mansa of Insuta Asante, the late Nana Amechampoma I, Ahina Namahima of Sikeja, the late Nana Amadapa of Pejahima. Nenefia was such a model of sterling traditional cultural, moral, social, and religious character traits that when the Asantehene Nana Sewa Nyakun II died, Otumfo Pokora II had no hesitation whatsoever in selecting her as the 13th Asantehene in 1977 at the age of 72. Nenefia Kubise Wampim II exhibited rare qualities of humanity, friendship, love, and justice as a human being. She was a woman who loved her children exceedingly well, but she never excluded other members of the royal family and outside the royal family from her kindness as the mother of the Asantes. Biologically, she was the mother of Otumfo Osei-Tutu II, whom she judiciously selected as the king of Asante, as it was her duty when Otumfo Pokora II, who had made her Asantehene, passed away. As Asantehene, she saw to it that neither Otumfo Pokora II nor Otumfo Osei-Tutu II discriminated in their munificence to members of the royal family and others. If it is the duty of a natural mother to advise her son, who is in a big position of responsibility, it is even more the case for Nenehime to advise the king as a cultural mother. This duty, Nenefia Kubise Wampim II performed to an extraordinary degree. She encouraged her sons. She supported them in the good things they did, advised them on the right path, bore their sorrows and joys, their triumphs and their frustrations. She brought her tremendous wealth of wisdom to bear on the traditional rule of her sons, Otumfo Pokora II and Otumfo Osei-Tutu II. There is no doubt that because Otumfo Osei-Tutu II followed the wise counsel of a devoted mother in the double sense of biological birth and cultural exigency, it became possible after his installment as King of Asante to become known as King Solomon. Through the urging and advice of Nenefia Kubise Wampim II, a special day was set aside for Ahima of Asante during the 15th anniversary celebration of Otunfo's 82's installment. But interestingly enough, the Ahima of Dinchra in the central region, the Ahima from Achim in the eastern region, and the Ahima from the Volta region also came to the celebration. This helped to give the occasion a national character. Nana Ahima was a life patron of the Ghana Women Initiative Foundation, established by Dr. Esa Okulu and others. The functions of the foundation were to encourage the education of girls, the empowerment of women, the inculcation of good traditional and moral values in women, etc. Even though she was of royal blood, Nana Ahima Kobisa Wampim II was never boastful. She pointed out what was wrong and what was right to those concerned. Right from her infancy, she never dressed up immodestly. And from the time of her installment, she was renowned for her exemplary hard work and industriousness. It should be recalled that before she became Asante Ahima, Nana Ahima had passed books from UAC, CFAO, and UTC, with which she engaged in the sale of cloth and other trading activities. She also dealt in the sale of lumber products, which were supplied by her nephew, Ohinimba Osebunzu, of TAT fame. As a young girl, she served ungrudgingly her senior relatives. These included her predecessor, Nana Masewa Nyaku. In her early years, a prophetic statement was made that she and her son would in the future hold responsible positions in society. Although Nana Ahima Kobisa Wampim II was a woman of culture to the core, she was also a committed Christian. At the age of 22, she was baptized and confirmed in the Anglican faith at St. Cyprian's Anglican Church in Kumasi. This was in 1927, 3 years after the return of King Prempeh I from the Seychelles Islands in 1924. The name given to her at her christening was Mariafo, but this was a corrupted form of Afoduo, her father's name. She enrolled in the Good Shepherd Society of the Church and held on to her faith. Until her death, she was a communicant. The Anglican clergy of St. Cyprian's Cathedral frequently said mass for her and her son at the Menchia Palace. Her second husband, being a Catholic, asked for her last two children to be baptized in the Catholic Church. Indeed, it was the present Catholic Archbishop Emeritus of Kumasi, the Most Reverend Peter Kwesi Sapong, who baptized Bemeko Okudia, the present Asante Ahima. Kumasi Mai, Asante Mai, and Ghana, hail you, Nana Ahima Kobisa Wampim II, as the embodiment of what is best in Ghanaian womanhood. You had a tremendous sense of discipline. You would not succumb to political pressure to influence your choice of the King of Asante. You were blessed with the old age of 111 years, during which you never completely lost any of your faculties or senses. You had a colossal memory and sharp mind, which right up to your passing away did not diminish. You were able to remember people, places, events, and occurrences, and you remember them with amazing ease and in incredible minute detail. God, your Creator, even while you were still alive, had shown satisfaction in your performance as Ohima. Go to your mother Mary. She will conduct you to her son, and her son will introduce you to your great ancestors of Oyoko at Asamando. Nana Deye.
Of a negative connotation with some women. I was fortunate to have had in Nane Fia Kobi Sewampim a perfect mother-in-law devoid of such a trait. From the very beginning of my marriage to Otumfuo Osei-Tutu II, I dreaded to the core my first introduction to Nana Hima, as we all affectionately called her. I knew I would not just be meeting any mother-in-law, but one who happened to be no meaner person than the Asante Hima. Secondly, I had heard that my Achim heritage would definitely be an issue for her and the elders who would object to Otumfuo marrying an Achim woman. When I eventually met her, I felt totally accepted. She eased all the anxiety I had harbored, and she became my other mother. I believe she was more interested in my character than where I came from. She rather wondered whether I would be a good partner for her son, whom she was so passionate about and who was always her top priority. Nana Hima immediately took me under her wing and helped me settle into what was going to be a different and fairly challenging lifestyle for me. I remember a visit from her in the very first week of moving to Kumasi. On hearing Nana Hima had sent some of her attendants to see me, my mind went flying in several different directions as I tried to guess what the reason for this visit could be. I had been told all sorts of stories by people who claimed to know the kind of life I would face after marrying into such a sacred, huge, and very traditional institution. So I was easily intimidated. To my surprise and delight, the ladies were carrying baskets with all sorts of pots and pans, and they informed me that Nana Hima had sent me some fufu and soup, as she realized I had probably not been able to organize my kitchen yet and was most likely missing some good home cooking. The soup, I discovered to my delight, was ebunebunu, with huge snails, bush meat, assorted dried fish, etc., to welcome the Achim lady. Nana Hima's soup, as I am sure all can imagine, was special. As soon as I saw it, I knew I had come home. This was followed a few days later with a talk and the accompaniments of pear and kobe, prepared in the typical Asante way. Thus started a ritual whereby various mouth-watering soups and other Asante dishes were alternatively delivered to me twice every week. In this way, the void of the loss of my own mother's soup was immediately filled. To have my mother-in-law and someone in her exalted position take such a personal interest in my well-being was truly humbling and heartwarming. I began to wonder if Nana Hima and my biological mother had not been close in the pre-existence. As I settled in the royal circles, and as was expected, I would make mistakes. When I did, Nana Hema would always defend me before sending for me and pointing me in the right direction. This was a true mother who would cover the mistakes of her child and then guide him or her on the right path. An interesting example of this was when I would go around without using the third piece or cover cloth of my cover and slit, oblivious of the anxiety I was causing. When Nana Hema was told, and knowing that this was probably a new thing for me, she was quick to defend me, arguing that I did not necessarily have to wear the third piece if I wasn't used to it. I could just drape it over my arm or shoulder, as is the fashion now. She then corrected me gently that whatever the case, I should always carry the third piece on me. After this, we had quite a lengthy discussion on fashion do's and don'ts, and it was fascinating to observe how someone who had had such a traditional upbringing was still so open-minded and understood that times were changing, and so there was the need for me to be accommodated in certain situations. In any other case, I am sure a lecture with the usual telling off, most likely behind one's back, as they say, would have taken place, but not with Nana Hema. I never heard one harsh word from her. She treated me like one of her own. For the various traditional festivals and funerals at which I had to wear dancing crown, she would always send someone to inquire if I had the right cloth or if I needed help. And she would always have a wide variety of cloths sent to me from which to make my selection. As I said, I have heard women telling mother-in-law stories, some funny, some not so much, and some quite dreadful. I also have tons of stories I could tell, except that, thankfully, they were all edifying. I consider Nana Hema's passing as the homegoing of one of God's most precious gifts to me. I will always remember the advice she gave me, particularly the life lessons she taught me. The rejoicing, merrymaking, and drumming on the birth of my children were very special. She personally supervised the performance of all the traditional rites and rituals that had to be made to welcome them. The interest she took in my projects and NGO, appreciating the times were changing, and so my role as Ohneere would be slightly different, are worth noting. She gave her blessing for me to be a bit more visible and active in public. She was such a wise and gracious woman, and I am glad I took her advice, for it has definitely been one of the reasons for my successful life among Asante royalty. Nana Hema's relationship with Otumfo was just beautiful to watch. The total picture of her, as I saw it, was someone who lived her Christian life, loved her culture, which she cherished, and was deeply fond and protective of Otumfo, on whom she doted and embraced her family and her people. I will never forget the numerous occasions she would send for me to inquire about Otumfo's well-being, asking why he had adjudicated for so long on a particular day, and encouraging me to advise him against such lengthy sessions. She would give directions on who could and could not do certain things for Otumfo, who to talk to in her household if I needed any Asante delicacies for Ohne or his friends, and advice on certain things or people she was not comfortable with. She loved her son exceedingly, which love was equally reciprocated by him. Her wholehearted acceptance and love of me, I know, was due to the love and respect for Tumfo, which I believe made her ready to accept whoever his choice of a partner was to be, and agreed to love and unflinchingly protect me the way she did to him. I am very much aware that my best friend in the whole world, my love, my rock, has lost the woman who shaped him into who he is today, who loved, cared, and protected him. And I hope I can be half the woman she was for him. Nana Himma will be sorely missed, but never forgotten. It is a sort of a joke that every wife gets annoyed by her mother-in-law. But what wouldn't I give to have mine around for a little longer? She possessed so much beauty, grace, love, and patience that I find it a great pity she was already well advanced in age when I came into her life. To me, she will always be the amazing woman who gave me a husband far better than anyone deserves. And I will forever be grateful that I was a part of her life. Nane Fia Kobi Sewam Pim II. Santi Hima. Demri Fedri. Dre. Asipa Nanti Ye. Oba Taimpa. Waye Biampa. Kodru Fie Jojo.